From Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 34, Text 32. Shankhachudam nihatyevam manim adaya bhaswaram manim adaya bhaswaram agrajaya dadat pritya pashyanti nam chayoshitam shankachudam nihatyevam manim adaya bhaswaram agrajaya dadat pritya pashyanti nam cha yoshitam pashyanti nam cha yoshitam shankachudam nihatyevam manim adaya bhaswaram agrajaya dadat pritya pashyanti nam cha yoshitam. Please repeat after me. Shankachudam, the demon Shankachuda. Nihatya, killing. Evam, in this manner. Manim, the jewel. Adaya, taking. Bhaswaram, brilliant. Agrajaya, to his elder brother. Adadat, gave. Pritya, with satisfaction. Pashyanti nam, as they were watching. Cha, and. Yoshitam, the woman. Translation by Srila Prabhupada. Having thus killed the demon Shankachuda and taken away his shining jewel, Lord Krishna gave it to his elder brother with great satisfaction as the gopis watched. Purport by Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki. Various gopis perhaps thought that Govinda would give one of them the valuable jewel. To prevent rivalry among them, Shri Krishna happily gave the jewel to his elder brother, Balarama. So how many of us were able to completely absorb in Jai Radha Madhava? It's in front of us, how tough it is to control our mind, isn't it? Even if we want to, with all sincerity, all effort, the mind is taking us away. And today's pastime that we are going to hear about, talk about, discuss, is also something related to one of the important factors that doesn't allow our mind to focus. And these are the anarthas. And one of the anarthas is to have pride, false pride, false ego, because of fame and wealth. Kunti Maharani in Srimad Bhagavatam tells us, Janmaishwarya Shruta Shribhir. Edhamana Madha Puman. Madha means intoxicated. Edhamana means increasingly intoxicated. Increasingly intoxicated with birth in high family, fame, opulence, education, beauty, wealth. These are actually disqualifications on the path of devotional service. Kunti Maharani is telling. Especially for the people who are increasingly engaging or intoxicated by these. And one such person in this material world is Shankachuda. When I'm saying is, means somewhere this pastime is happening as we are talking. These are Nitya Leelas of the Lord. So Shankachuda was a very, very close associate of Kuvera, one of the Yakshas who was associating very closely with Kuvera. And Kuvera, we know, is the treasurer of demigods. Sometime back, in Padmanabha Swami temple in Trivandrum, one room they opened and they found that room full of jewels. And the entire world, it was a news which was going around for days together. So imagine, we can't even imagine actually, what will be the quantity of this wealth that Kuvera has of all the devatas. He is the treasurer. And how tough it will be for him to have all this wealth and yet not be bewildered. He somehow manages, we know some pastimes where he has also slipped. But what we have also seen is people who are associating with him are slipping more. We have heard about Nalakuvera and Manigriva, completely intoxicated by youth. And the fact that, you know, they are Kuvera's children. To an extent that when Narad Muni comes, when they were bathing naked in Manasarovar in Vrindavan, they were not bothered to even give any, you know, like weightage to Narad Muni. Because we are so wealthy. Wealth brings with it this type of a, you know, feeling that I am the richest. Yes, superiority complex. So people should bow in front of me. Why should I stand up when Narad Muni has come? Women with whom they were, they all ran away because it's not appropriate to stay in front of a rishi like Narada. But Nalakuvera and Manigriva were there. It was Narada's blessing to them that he told them, okay, stay naked as a tree. But that too in Nanda Maharaj's courtyard. What better blessing than that? And then we have Shankachuda, another associate of Kuvera. Shankachuda was so obsessed with the fact that he was an associate of Kuvera and very rich, very wealthy. In fact, he had in the entire creation, the most precious jewel he had, and that jewel he kept in the center of his crown. And even while sleeping, he won't remove it. Sometimes when we see television or these videos of Ramayana and Mahabharata, we see kings are wearing so many jewels, crown and... And we believe that, you know, they will always be wearing those. It will be very tough for them. So only when they are for a moment going to the courtyard, to their court, that is when they would wear those type of jewels in that moment. But other times they would be, you know, more or less in their relaxed clothes. But Shankachuda would always wear that jewel because that was like his pride. It was the day of Purnima, Holika, Holy Purnima, which nowadays we also celebrate as Gaur Purnima. And the moon was shining very bright. In Vrindavan, Krishna and Balaram, they along with the gopis went into the forest. And on Purnima, going into the forest, the whole moonlight was shining like golden, whitish moonlight falling on the trees and the plants of Vrindavana. In the night time, the Mallika flowers were intoxicating. The smell in the entire environment was so intoxicating that the bees, the birds, all were, you know, on high. Krishna and Balaram with the gopis, when they were running in the forests, and when they were seeing the lakes on both the side with lotus flowers, have you seen on the Purnima, it's very, even on a usual moonlit day, night, there is a lot of visibility. But on Purnima, it's very, very visible. So the lotus flowers in the ponds and in the lakes were very beautiful. The stars which were reflecting in these lakes were like necklaces and the jewels, as if scattered on the floor, on the ground. And in the midst of all this, Krishna and Balaram started singing. Now, when we sing, you know, people run away. I know there are many good singers here. I cannot talk in a generic sense like this. But when Krishna and Balaram sing, they were singing in all the seven notes together. And not only the gopis and the devatas who were hearing from the Swargaloka, but even Krishna and Balaram themselves got intoxicated by their own singing. They went in that mood. And then they were all dancing, they were running around in the forest, completely enjoying the moment. At that very moment, Shankachuda happens to come there. And Shankachuda, when he comes there, he sees that so many beautiful women are over there in one place. And one thing which wealth and intoxication from wealth brings is a sense of possession. I can buy everything. You know, what is there unreachable for me? Everything can be mine. So Shankachuda, in that intoxicated sense of wealth, feels that, wow, such beautiful women over here. Just to give you a brief description, once one brahmachari, Prabhupada catches him, and that brahmachari still had the photo of his girlfriend with him. And Prabhupada talks to him, what is this? Why are you carrying this with you? So the brahmachari says, Prabhupada, I am appreciating Krishna's beauty. See, you know, Krishna, everything what is given is from Krishna. And in my past I had, you know, this was one of my friend. And isn't it beautiful, Prabhupada? So Prabhupada looks at him, and he was in anticipation that, you know, Prabhupada will maybe say that, you know, yeah, she is good, she is beautiful. Prabhupada gave a very generic response saying, the most beautiful woman on planet Earth is, sorry, Matajis, don't feel offended. The most beautiful woman on this earth is not more beautiful than a horse in the Swargaloka. So that's what Prabhupada told. Men also is horse in that case. So it's so we should not feel proud either. And those damsels in heaven, when they walk, they are like thousand times more beautiful than what we are talking about women on earth. And Lakshmi ji in Vaikuntha is million trillion times, it's just an upma I am giving, which you cannot count, more beautiful than, we cannot even comprehend, than the apsaras or the damsels in heaven. And Lakshmi ji, and when we are comparing to gopis, so you can imagine what will be their beauty. So Shankachuda happened to see these gopis. He felt, these are mine. And then he takes a stick and starts ushering them towards north. And he's a yaksha. He's very huge, handsome. He is intoxicated with that I am very beautiful, I am wealthy. And then he starts ushering them towards north. So all the gopis, they start screaming, "Oh Krishna, oh Balarama, help me, help us, save us from this, person who is creating this atrocity on us." And then Krishna and Balaram, when they hear, they start calling from where they were also, "Don't worry, we are coming." And then they start running towards Shankachuda, along with the logs of wood in their hand. Now it is told, Rupa Goswami tells, that when I say Rupa Goswami tells, it's not that I have read Rupa Goswami, but I have heard in one of the lectures from one of the senior Vaishnavas in ISKCON, and he's saying that Rupa Goswami shares, so I'm just sharing as it is. So Rupa Goswami shares that at the very moment when Shankachuda is running with the gopis and Krishna and Balaram are running behind him with the logs in the head, Shankachuda turns behind and sees Krishna and Balaram. And what he sees for the first moment, he sees Krishna as Kala and Balarama as death personified. He starts getting sweat. But the very moment when he sees Krishna as Kala and Balarama as death personified, the gopis see Krishna as their savior, as a protector. Balarama they see as a protector. So what is the difference in the two visions? The moment is same. Krishna, Balaram are same. They are running behind. The very moment one person is seeing them as savior and the protector, and the other person is seeing them as death personified and Kala. So it is actually our vision. It's actually the way we are looking at Krishna, the way we are looking at Balaram is what makes the difference. And what makes that difference? It is our mind. It is our mind which is intoxicated with so much pride and envy. Yeah? Chanchalam hi manaha Krishna pramati balavadradam. Taryaham nigraham manye vayor eva sudushkaram. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is telling, for the mind is restless, turbulent, obstinate and very strong, O Krishna. And to subdue it is, it seems to me, more difficult than controlling the wind. Arjuna is talking to Krishna, is saying, has anybody tried holding a wind or controlling a wind here? Can somebody control wind over here? Arjuna is talking about controlling our mind is more difficult than controlling the wind. Who believes Arjuna is telling false? It's important when we go to a doctor, the first thing is to diagnose what is the problem. Then we can look at the cure. And that realization and that acceptance has to come in, that what is the problem. So Shankachuda looks at Krishna and Balaram as death personified and as Kala. It is told, a kitten in the mouth of a cat and the rat in the mouth of the cat, the situation is same. But are both of them looking at cat in the same way? No. The kitten in the mouth of a cat, have you seen how the cat lifts the kitten from this neck area? And it is the same teeth. But the kitten feels that's the safest place in this creation. I am with my mother cat. Yeah? And the rat feels the opposite. The rat feels that I am in the most dreadful place in this creation. How are we reciprocating with Krishna? Ye yatha mam prapadhyante tamstate bhajamyaham mam vartamanu vartante manushya partha sarvashah. If we are full of these anarthas, of pride, envy, jealousy, greed, lust, ego, believe me, we are seeing Krishna from these glasses. We are not seeing Krishna as He is. We are seeing Him through these lenses of anarthas. I will come to it little later. So Shankachuda, he starts running away from there. He throws his stick. He leaves the gopis behind because he sees that up to me, gone, you know, I'm dead. So he starts running away, and Krishna, he asks Balram that you please stay here with all the gopis, I will just come back. And he starts running behind Shankachuda. And Shankachuda, immediately when he sees Krishna approaching him, he manifests his fangs. He's a yaksha, he can change his roop. And the moment Krishna sees that, he takes his hand and strikes him on his head. Immediately his head falls apart. Shri Krishna Bhagavan ki. Devotees feel very happy when we hear about killing and of the demons especially. Yeah? The most soft-hearted of the devotees also feel very happy. So he takes the jewel from the crown of Shankachuda and returns back. And that's what Prabhupada is saying. Various gopis perhaps thought that Govinda would give one of them the valuable jewel. But no. Krishna gave it to his brother Balaram. That you please keep it with yourself. In our scriptures, there are so many beautiful moments of brotherly love, family aspects which keep coming. Krishna could have given it to the gopis, but Krishna decided to give it to Balaram, his brother. Today there is so much fights between brother and brother, friend and friend, relatives, parents and children. I think it's important we learn from, you know, Ram and Bharat, Krishna and Balaram. These are stories and pastimes for us to learn and live like that, not just to maybe come to the temple and hear and then go back and continue what we are doing. Balram took that jewel and immediately gave it to Srimati Radharani. He felt unqualified. Balram, whatever he does it to enable Radharani and Krishna's pastimes. That is his mood of a servant, of the servant of the servant. He gave it to Srimati Radharani, and Radharani kept it in her necklace. Krishna told Radharani that this jewel that you have is non-different than Kaustubha money that I have. It's as beautiful, as precious as Kaustubha money. So Radha, whenever Krishna was not there with him, would look at that jewel and cry. Because for a moment separation from Krishna, it's not possible for her. She's always in present, what we were talking about in the beginning. She's absorbed in Krishna. And when Krishna is not there in front of her, she would see that money and would cry and wash that jewel with her tears. She would go to the sun temple in Vrindavan and worship sun god. But she was going there only because Krishna used to come there. So they used to meet in the sun temple. And it happened for a long time. But then Akrura took Krishna away to Mathura, never to come back. So Radharani would see the jewel and stay satisfied that, you know, this is like Kaustubha money, what Krishna told me. And with Vishakha, one day went to the sun temple. There in the sun temple, she got this intense desire that I should thank sun god. That, you know, because I was coming to this temple, Krishna used to come here and you became one enabler for my meeting with Krishna. And in separation from Krishna, this intense feelings I cannot tolerate. She took her jewel and gave it to the sun god. And with the passage of time, this jewel which she gave to sun god gave it to his disciple Satrajit. And Satrajit got this jewel. See, when you are not the right patra to get something, you will misuse it. That was also a very important principle which in Bharat we were following, that only one who is a patra should get the knowledge or should get something which is Rani for so long. He immediately went into the mood of Vrindavana. And this jewel, if we happen to think, Shankachuda, Satrajit, why so many people had to die for this jewel? Couldn't they have given it to Krishna? If Krishna was coming behind them, they could have just given. Krishna would have blessed them, given them love of Godhead. What more precious than that? Yes or no? Please raise your hand if you say yes, that, you know, Satrajit and Shankachuda should have given this. I didn't see many hands raised over there. So I know some jewels are very precious for Matajis. So one are the physical jewels, but then also each one of us are holding to our jewels, like Shankachuda. Each one of us is holding to our pride. Each one of us is holding to our envy, our jealousy, our false ego, lust, greed, material hankering. That is why Shankachuda, Rupa Goswami says, is an embodiment of trying to take what is Krishna's in the pretext of being a devotee. Such a big comparison Rupa Goswami ji is giving, that Shankachuda represents trying to control or take things what belongs to Krishna in the pretext of being a devotee. Because the moment we become a devotee, we start, you know, becoming more popular. We start getting good qualities. People start getting attracted to us. We start becoming famous. Name, fame. Pehle koi sunta nahi tha. Abhi vyasasan pe baithe hai, kitna log baith ke sun rahe hai na? Hai na? So immediately, you know, one jewel has come here in the center of the invisible crown. Yeah? So it's important that we understand how our mind is playing with us. Mind is the glue between Krishna and Maya. Prabhupada used to say, the biggest fear I have is my disciples are not sufficiently afraid of Maya. And somehow we feel, ho jayega. Prabhuji, sare anartha dur ho gaye, bas ek yehi. Only this anartha is, to matlab, false ego to pehle se hi saath mein hai, addition. Ek ke saath ek, free. So Krishna is telling, Uddharet atmanatmanam, natmanam avaradayet. Atmaiva hi atma bandhur, atmaiva ripur atmanaha. Mind is the, a man must elevate himself by his own mind, not degrade himself. The mind is the friend of the conditioned soul and his enemy as well. Devi esha gunamai mama maya durattaya. Krishna is telling in Gita, she is the most difficult, and she is mama maya, and we feel that nahi hum to manage kar sakte hain. So it's very important that we understand that we have these anarthas in us, and our material hankering, our envy, our jealousy, especially Shankachuda represents false pride due to the possession of material opulence, wealth, beauty. So we need to understand that we recognize we have this disease of having this false pride which is keeping us away from Krishna, not allowing us to see Him as He is. Now let us see, how can we overcome this? How can we address this disease when we understand that this disease is there? There are two things which are given to us, and we should feel very lucky that we are having access to these two things. And we have heard about it many times before. Every day when we start our chanting, we are talking about the 10 offenses. The 10th offense is, despite of repeated instructions and messages, continuing to maintain our material attachments. So I am not going to tell anything new. But what's important is to understand the importance and use these methods to overcome our anarthas. Sadhana and sadachar are the two aspects given to us to overcome this aspect of our mind which is keeping us away from Krishna. We also in some sense are taking the gopis away, like Shankachuda. Because we are trying to take away what belongs to Krishna, and we feel it is ours, and we are taking it away. Many people have spoken about sadhana, chanting. I will not talk about it at this moment, but I would like to bring few aspects of how we can ensure that our acharana is also improving, our consciousness is improving. Mantra is the method of controlling the mind, and hence Hare Krishna Mahamantra, which is what we chant, is one method, and Sadachar is another. In acharan, especially since we are talking about possession of wealth of Sankachuda, the only way, and I am not talking about this, the only way for human beings, once what happens, Danavas, Devas and Manushya, Manavas, they all go to Brahma. the story is told in Brihad Aranyaka Upanishad, part of our Vedas. They all go to Lord Brahma and they approach to him and ask him, please tell us our kartavya. What is our kartavya? So Brahmaji cannot be more cryptic than this. Tells them, da. So demigods, demons and manavas all are confused. What does da mean? So they all go to Brihaspati and they talk to him. That can you please tell us, we went to Lord Brahma and asked what is our kartavya, and Brahma told us da. So Brihaspati ji laughs and then tells to the demons, for demons, daityas, da means daya. Because you are so cruel that you take pleasure in hurting others. You take pleasure when others are in pain. You kill others recklessly. So for you, da means daya. For devatas, the demigods, da, Brihaspati tells, means daman. Because you are in heaven, you have access to everything, unlimited. Food, pleasure, jewels, clothes, singing, dancing, enjoying your life, big lifetime, lifespan, good health. It's told that demigods, when they die, they are healthy till the last day, and then so it is so much of opulence and pleasure is there. So people in heaven, they need to control their senses, and hence Brahma told demigods and devatas daman. And imagine, this is a message in Upanishads, in Vedas. To Manushya, Brihaspati tells, the only way is daan. Da means daan. Because we are very attached to the matter. We are very attached to the material possessions. So the only way to overcome this connection with this matter, so attached to the beauty, so attached to the wealth, so attached to the family, so attached to the, whatever is our possessions here. Daan is the way, charity, through which we can cut our or overcome. So that's one important point I wanted to share, that it's important that we first recognize the disease that we have, like Sankachuda, possessing what is Krishna's, this wealth belongs to Krishna. If Shankarchuda and Satrajit would have given this jewel to Krishna, Krishna would have given them blessings and would have given them maybe love of Godhead. But they tried to keep it to themselves and in the process lost their life and lost an opportunity to serve Krishna. In the same way, if we continue to keep these possessions with us, we will lose our lives, we will lose this opportunity. So let us give our jewels to Krishna, to Jagannath Baldev Subhadramai, when we come here to the temple, offer it to them and take their blessings and stay protected. Any questions that you have? Yes, bro. The question is, when we talk about Daan, is it only about Lakshmi or is it also in broader sense? It is in both. When I'm talking about Daan, Shramadan is also Daan. So giving our time for Sevas is also Daan. But one should not just stop at that. Giving our time and giving our shrama is a much, I would say, is a more holistic way of. But what Daan, I think, what Brahmaji meant here was actually related to the. So when we serve, we develop humility. Because Gopir Bhartur Pad Kamalayo Das 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 Anudas. When we are doing seva, we develop that propensity of doing seva, of a servant, of the servant of the servant. So doing seva is also one type of a daan. It helps us overcome our anarthas of feeling, the possessor of everything, rather than it brings in us the feeling of servitude. So humility develops. Trinadapi sunichaiva tarorapi sahishnuna amanena manadena kirtaneya sadahari. So when we have such mood, we can meditate, we can chant better, we can surrender to Krishna. But along with that, it's important to also give Daan, which is in the form of Lakshmi. Because that brings in detachment from the matter. So its objective is different. That there is this type of a possession that everything belongs to me, or even if not, everything that is mine belongs to me at least. But the jewel was Krishna's at first place. He took it from Shankarchuda, gave it to Balarama, Balarama gave it to Radharani, Radharani gave it to Suryadev, Suryadev gave it to Satrajit, and Krishna got it back. So it belongs to Krishna. We feel that, you know, it is mine. In the meantime, I feel that this belongs to me. Mama Maya, Krishna is saying, it is mine. And it is very, very tough. Duratyaya. So to overcome that, the only way is, he is also giving the method. Either you associate with me or you associate with Maya. Ye beech ka rasta nahi chalta hai. Matlab, kabhi idhar, kabhi udhar, kabhi idhar, kabhi udhar. That's again one offense on the power of the holy name. It's like the mad elephant offense. Hum log jo karte hain. Hum log, elephant goes, takes bath, comes out, rolls in the dust. So we feel that, you know, now mere 16 round ho gaya, abhi maine Krishna ke saath associate kiya, abhi main kuch bhi kar sakta hun. So then we do everything which is, you know, not aligned with what Krishna is here for. Yeah? Yada yada ye dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyutthanam adharmasya tadatmanam srujamyam. So Krishna is coming here to re-establish dharma. So we need to identify what is my swadharma and what is Krishna's dharma. And all these things are very important. In this human birth only it is possible. Yeah? For demigods, daman is much difficult than for human beings, dan. Yeah? We were in Europe for 5 years. And I had been in America also. Why when somebody goes there, never comes back? Yeah? It's like, you know, a fraction of a swargaloka, you can say. In India, you get the taste of both, you know. You keep getting, it's in balance. You get kadwa and you get meetha. That's why on Yugadi we taste both, no? Beu bela. Yeah? In America they will feel, you know, you're mad people, you're eating neem like that. But we want to eat bitter. And we are welcoming bitter. That is what, you know, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu means when he says, Bharat Bhumi mein janma liya hai, to auron pe paropakar kiyo. We have to understand what it means to take birth in Bharat Bhumi. What do we mean by being Bharatiya? How can we become, you know, more Westerners in our practice? Let us become Bharatiya in our practice. Let us become, when Mahaprabhu is saying Bharatiya, aap Bharatiya ho, what does it mean? It doesn't mean taking birth only in Bharat Bhumi. A person who has taken birth in America can be more Bharatiya than Bharat. Person who has taken birth in Bharat Bhumi. It's about living that type of a life. Believing in Bharatiyata, believing in being, you know, what is this? So this thought process of detaching ourselves from matter is given in Gita. It belongs to Bharatiya Drishtikon. It belongs to Dharma. Krishna is coming here to re-establish Dharma. So these are the points that we have to connect these dots. Yeah? So when we do service, do Shrama, Seva in the temple, Seva in the Samaj, Seva for, you know, in Krishna's service, we are talking about detaching ourselves from our false pride of being the controller and the possessor and becoming a servant. But when we are doing Daan in the material form, it is detaching ourselves from the matter, from the attachments that we have with Maya, from the attachments that we have with our possessions. So one is the physical possession and one is the mental possession. So in both these dimensions, we have to address our attachments.